the word you hear that cleanses your mind. When your mind has been cleansed, your life is holy. If you are not taught who Christ is, you cannot live an effective Christian life. There is no other honor greater than that of sonship. Worldliness is the trap that enslaves men to the devil.
Relationship with God is a gift. Fellowship is a choice. The true expression of divine love is forgiveness to others. What you pursue is an expression of what you desire.
Speak, thus says the Lord, even the carcasses of men shall fall as refuse field after the harvest, and no one shall gather them. Take from verse 23. Read, thus saith the Lord, let not the wise man glory in his wisdom, let not the mighty man glory in his might, nor let the rich man glory in his riches. Verse 24. But let him who glories glory in this, that he understands and knows me, that I am the Lord. Exercising loving kindness, judgment, and righteousness in the earth, for in this I delight in the Lord. Say that again. Let not the wise man boast of his wisdom, or the strong man boast of his strength, or the rich man boast of his riches. Are you seeing what God is saying? The wise don't boast in your wisdom. The strong don't boast in your strength. Now, but let him boast about this, that he understands and knows me, that I am the Lord. Look here. Mark the scripture. Let not the wise man boast in his wisdom. Let not the strong man boast in his strength. Let not the rich man boast in his riches. But let him who boast in this, that I am the Lord, that he understands me and knows me. The knowledge of God. Listen to this. The scripture makes us to understand that every boast in material things will provoke the anger of God against you. If you boast that you have money, you are provoking God to permit Satan collect the money from you. If you boast that your husband is the most handsome man, you are provoking God to permit Satan kill him for you. If you boast that you are the strongest man, you are provoking God to permit Satan raise somebody that will kill you in a hurry. He says, let no man boast of any material thing. So every time you boast of material things, you provoke the anger of God against your life. And can I tell you something? If there is something we see today, people make their boast in what they have. I am rich. I am strong. I am tall. I am married. You are not married. I am this, you are that. He says, let no man boast in that. Let no man boast. Let not the wise man boast in his wisdom. Let not the strong man boast of his strength. Let not the rich man boast of his riches. People of God, there are people who have boasted about certain things they have, and they lost them in less than no time. If you study scripture, there was a man called Nebuchadnezzar. He woke up and he boasted and said, I am a mighty king. Now, Nebuchadnezzar was the richest man on earth in his time. The richest man. He was richer than every man, stronger than every man. And his nation was the strongest nation. But he woke up and said, Nebuchadnezzar said, he said, look at me. I am rich and I am strong. He said, the same day, he became an animal and ate grass for 7 years. Why? He boasted. Be careful. He boasted of his strength. The deception of material possessions is that they deceive us to put our trust in them. A time comes when you actually think that you are alive because you have money. God says, I will show you that you are alive because I gave you grace. A time comes that you think you are married because you are beautiful, and God shows you that I will show you that you got married because I gave you grace. When we take our eyes off the grace of God, we begin to appreciate our strength for the things we have. Was turned into a goat and ate grass for 7 years. Why? Because he boasted. Ladies and gentlemen, from the time Jesus called me, I've made up my mind. I shall never boast of what I do through him. I can prophesy. God will show you that you cannot prophesy. Everything we do is done by the grace of God. There is nothing you do, even if you don't see God, God's hand is always inside whatever you have that is good. He may not show himself physically, but in behind the scene, God has been acting to make you have the things you have had. Nebuchadnezzar, in one day, he left from the mightiest king to a goat. God turned a man, a human being. Bible says, and hair grew on his body, and his nails became long, and he ate grass for 7 years from the throne to the forest. There was a king called Herod. In Acts chapter 12, he said one day Herod made a speech. He said when Herod made the speech, the people said, this is the voice of a God. He said, and God sent an angel, and the angel slapped Herod, and worms ate him alive, and he died. Why? Bible says the angel killed him because he did not give glory to God. You don't understand? Because he passed his exam. He said, boy, you get sense. He stay quiet. He doesn't say, no, let me sense. Now God give me. No, I read for the exam. There is a wrong tendency in us to appreciate our strength for the things we receive, not knowing that whatever we have today is an expression of the mighty mercy and the grace of God. It means when a man turns and looks at his wife, he says, Lord, thank you for this woman. When a woman looks at a husband, Lord, thank you for my husband. You understand that you do not have the husband by your beauty. You understand that you do not get married to this woman by money. You understand that what you are today is not because you prayed more than somebody. Somebody prayed more than you. They are not alive today. There is nothing you have done that somebody has not done more than you and have not had the result you have. Let not the wise man boast in his wisdom. Let not the strong man boast in his strength. Let not the rich man boast in his riches. If any man should boast, let him boast that he knows me. In other words, no matter who you know, if you don't know God, you know nothing. No matter what you have, if you don't have Jesus, you have nothing. No matter where you are going to, if Jesus is not with you, you are going to nowhere. When you study Luke chapter 16, the Bible says there was a story of a man. He said the man was a rich man. They didn't give his name. He said there was a certain rich man. A certain what? No name. A certain rich man that was, he said, Bible says he was rich. He wore purple clothes. They described him by his garment, described him by the things he has. When you are described by your possession, it means you don't know God. Bible says a man's life does not consist of what he has. It's not what you have that make you, it's who you are. He described the man, then he said there was a poor man named Lazarus. Notice, the poor man had a name. The rich man had no name. The Bible says a time came. The rich man died and was buried. Lazarus died and was carried. You see, when he was in hell, he looked up and said, Lazarus, help me. Abraham said, my brother, when you were on earth, you enjoyed yourself with your possession, not knowing that whatever God gives you on earth, he has empowered you to help someone. And he was judged because the things that God gave him, he used it to live a prodigal life in drinking, womanizing, fornication, adultery, a wrong life. And God said, I will require it from you. Be careful. When God lifts you up, be careful of pride. When God brings you down, be careful of bitterness. Every time blessings come, pride follows. Every time blessing go, bitterness come. So when you are on the hill, my brother, if God does not lift you up, Satan cannot sight you well. Listen, you're in the crowd. Do you know why they put this altar up? It should be up so that wherever you are, you can see me up. It is easier to enter the church and see the man of God because he's lifted up. That's how life is. When we are all seated here, we cannot see you. But if God just take you and put you on a higher chair, you become the focus of everyone, both good and evil. So divine lifting can make a man the focus of the spirit of pride. Bible says pride comes before a fall. So pride never comes to men who are down. Only men who stand can fall. Pride comes before what? Can a fallen man fall? So if pride comes before a fall, it means pride comes mostly to the people who are where? That who are standing. One time, a man of God came from Nigeria and he came here. And he said to me, he said, he came here and he was looking for me. And he saw me. He told me that he's looking for the man of God. I told him, I said, the man of God has not come. He said, okay, he's waiting for him. I said, wait for him. So I sat down. After a while, church began. It's me that came back with microphone. So after service, he came to me. He said, why am I like that? Why don't I have policemen protocol? Why don't I have? And I look, wrong idea. He wants me to lift myself off. To now become a law to all of you. Don't greet me, I'm a mighty prophet. Don't talk to me. And I understood that there is a wrong conception today in the life of Christians. Blessings is what separates them from their own family. People that you could talk to, when God bless you, suddenly they don't become your level. You start trying to talk in a grammar that is not even correct. Because you are blessed. Now, the way the scripture began is frightful. Let not the wise man boast in his wisdom. Let not the strong man boast in his strength. Let not the rich man boast in his riches. Funnily, these are the three things people boast about. Their wisdom, their strength, and their riches. For a rich man, he thinks he can do anything to anybody at any time because his money. Bible says money is a defense unto the rich. Not knowing that if money is a defense to you, the name of the Lord is a stronger tower. For the wise. Oh, the wise. The wise use their wisdom to manipulate the foolish. And the strong. The strong use their strength to oppress the weak. Pastor Rito. The wise use their wisdom to manipulate the foolish. The strong use their strength to oppress the weak. And the rich use their riches to disgrace the poor. That's the life we live in. But God says, among those of you that are my children, no matter what I give you, don't boast of material things. Boast that you know me. So from this scripture we understand that the boasting that God recognizes is your boasting of your knowledge of Him. He said, if you should boast, say thank you that I know you. One time I was walking and I saw a sticker on a car. It was a church. It can be like, for example, I am proud to be an apostolic child. Okay? And I said, okay, I'll do this for AJ. And God said, no, it should not be I am proud to be, it should be I am humble to be. Even to say, I am proud to be an apostle, a child of God. I am humble. There is nothing good about pride. To be associated to a Christian, there is nothing good. Listen to me, child of God. It takes great, great character to see a man whom God has lifted still relate with others as if he had nothing. It is hard. There are many girls, as they get married, they cut off from all their friends. You call them, they don't pick. They say, I was busy cooking food for my husband. She's trying to tell you are not married. You don't understand. But when a man knows God and has an ability from God to see the future, you know that everything is vanity upon vanity. That a man can be up today and tomorrow is down. Let not the wise boast in what? We see something from this scripture. The desire of God for everyone is that we should know Him. Let them boast that they know me. Boast that I'm your Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jehovah, for saving me. The desire of God is that everyone should know Him. Bible says, He said, the knowledge of God shall cover the earth as the waters cover the sea. The knowledge of the glory of God, the desire of God is that everyone should know Him. Today, shockingly, even in church, we don't know God. Most of us know pastor. We don't know the God of the pastor. No doubt, we end up in hell. Why? Because we have come to church. We have not come to understand that a man of God comes to introduce his God to you, not himself. I'm not here to preach to you what I am or who I am. I'm here to reveal who God is to you so that you can know him and have a relationship with him. Am I talking to somebody here? That you may know him. You study Jeremiah 3 verse 15 to 16. He says what? I will give them shepherds after my heart that will feed the sheep with what? Knowledge and understanding. You are seeing again. It is the desire of God for everyone to know him. I will give them shepherds to feed them. Let them know who I am. Child of God, never leave a church where they preach the word to attend a church where they prophesy. Let me tell you. Prophecy is unto encouragement. Teaching is unto empowerment. Jesus is not revealed by the anointing. It's revealed by teaching. The anointing reveals the ability of God. The teaching reveals the identity of God. And if you know who God is, you will enjoy what God has. Am I talking to somebody here? Who is God to you? See the one? Gather Christians together. Ask them who is God. They cannot say. They don't know him. Because I am here because I'm sick. That's why I came here. I'm poor. No matter what you came here, God used that problem to bring you to church. But the reason he brought you is that you should know him. The solution to your problem is in your knowledge of God. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness and everything. How many things? Shall be added. Why? Because you know him. Hallelujah. You study Isaiah chapter 2, verse 3 to 4. Bible says, on the last days, we shall go to the house of the Lord and we shall say, teach us your ways. In the last days, we shall go to the house of the Lord. He said, the house of the Lord shall be established on the top of the mountains and people shall go there and say, teach us your ways so that we may walk in your path. It means the purpose of the house of God is to reveal the identity and the character of God to people. Listen, I can heal the sick everywhere. I can prophesy everywhere. Anytime. But when we come here, I must feed you who God is. I must give you the knowledge of God so you may grow. That's why his house is established. They can teach people who he is so people can have him and enjoy him. Am I talking to somebody here? Scripture says, oh, I love this. Paul said that I may know him. In Exodus chapter 33, from verse 12 to 14, there was a time Moses was praying. Moses said, he said, Lord, if I have found favor in your eyes, show me your ways so that I may know you. Wait, this is a man whom has opened the Red Sea. Till today, the miracles Moses did, people have not done them. He turned a stick to a serpent. He opened the Red Sea. And God asked him, what do you want? He said, show me your way. Let me know you. So Moses is saying that even after having done all those miracles, he does not still know God. Because God is revealed when he showed himself to you. Moses said, God, I want to know you. He said, and God said, okay, I'm coming. He said, the next day, God came and said, the Lord, good, merciful, compassionate, gracious, forgiving God. How did God reveal himself to Moses? By his character. I am a good God. I am forgiving. I am merciful. I am compassionate. Can I ask you a question? If God were to ask you now, what do you want? Will you say, I want to know you? Will you say, I want to know you? What do you want? Lord, I'm sick. Lord, I want to know you. That's what Moses said. He said, show me your way that I may know you. That I may know you. Glory. not with me to the Most High God. That I may do what? Know you. Everyone must go for the knowledge of God. You don't need me to tell you read your Bible. No. Every true Christian has the desire to know God more. When the Holy Spirit enters your life, He gives you the hunger to know God. You just sit down and say, let me read. Even if it's one chapter, one verse, you can't spend a day without knowing Him. People of God, you know, I believe there's no electricity. For why now? There's no light, no soul. The day you will come, you will hear the people will shout. You know why? Life without electricity on earth is terribly boring. There are so many things that you can do that you cannot do because there is no light. Now, the day light will come, the shouting will come, you see as it's rapture. Now, how do people now live without Jesus Christ, the light of God? If physical light has been taken away and people are confused, what will you do with that spiritual light? The difference is this. When there is no natural light, you can easily recognize. But when there is no spiritual light, you can still think there is light when there is no light. Unbelievers, for them, nothing is wrong with their life. When there is no natural light, it can be easily recognized. But when there is no spiritual light, it is hard to know that you don't have the light of God in you. But wait, if the absence of natural light is a hindrance to many things. In fact, some people came to this service to charge their phone. Don't put us aside there. Just one corner to charge them. Why? Now, all of you are forced to depend on people that have light. Same thing. When you are in a family, they don't have Christ, you have Christ. All of them supposed to depend on you because now you get light. That's how it happens spiritually. When you see on Sunday, people come here for prayer line, it's not me that heal them. What sickness is darkness? Poverty is darkness. In me is the light of God. When I stretch my hand and that light begins to shine, it begins to destroy those works. Now, that is the light you have to have. And nothing makes the light of God in you to shine bright as your knowledge of God. The more you know Him, the more your light shine brighter. Let your light so shine before men that they will see and glorify your Father. You see, me, I don't have any fear about my life. Because I am greatly dependent on the grace of God. I know where to invest my time and my effort. I invest my time and my effort in things that make me grow in my knowledge of God so my light can shine brighter. For a city on a hill cannot be hidden. Why? Because it's on light. Am I talking to somebody here? So, there is actually something that God is saying. He cried, He said, my people perish for lack of knowledge. Anywhere you see a Christian perishing, it's not for lack of power, for lack of knowledge. For example, you study Luke chapter 5. Peter was with, in the boat, trying to catch fish, and he didn't catch fish. Alright? The Bible says, Jesus entered his boat. Is that true? Okay. Jesus asked him to catch fish. To catch it where? Was it a different sea? In the same place where Peter was fishing and there was no result, when Jesus entered, everything changed. The same business you have been doing that is not working, and you are blaming all the witches of your village, as your knowledge of God increases, the business begins to prosper. Let me say this. The strength of Satan is the ignorance of Christians. And why are you ignorant? Because you don't want to know. If I'm saying, take your husband, amen. Take your child, amen. But listen to me. You possess your possessions by knowledge, not by amen. Any amen that is not full of revelation will bring forth nothing. It's like going to the bank and say, give me money. I don't have money there. They will beat you up. You must know who He is and what He has done for you. My people perish for which reason? No, lack of power. Lack of the anointing. Lack of knowledge. Lack of knowledge. In Luke 5, from verse 7 to 9, it says, when a woman lost a coin, she does what? She lights a lamp. Lamp gives light. In Genesis chapter 1, it said the earth was formless, empty and dark. The earth was formless. The earth was empty. What did God bring first? Light. What is light? Knowledge. Satan is not as strong as you think. Knowledge is what you don't have. They say, till we don't know, I'm senior you. What you don't know will oppress you. Do you know why people are afraid of darkness? It's because you don't know what can be hiding in darkness. You see this church now? You need fear. If they off light, they see me enter, you go fear. Not because of anything they did. You don't know to a fear day. You know, it means until no day. Amen. He said, if a man should boast, let him boast that he does. It means at the end of the day, a man's life is summarized by his knowledge of God. Whether you claim you have what, at the end of the day, what we want to see and know, does this man know God? And let me move ahead now. The knowledge of God does not speak just of scriptural understanding. No. The Ayakasha. The true expression of the knowledge of God is the character of God. Do you know that? The true expression of the knowledge of God is not the power of God. It's what? The character of God. The true expression of the knowledge of God is not just manifesting his power, it's demonstrating his character. Okay, for example, I'm a Christian and and something happens and there is a quarreling in my quarter and I say, this is my neighbor, I will never forgive you. Now, the character of God is what? Forgiveness. The character of the devil is bitterness. Now, if no matter the miracles I perform, no matter the blind eyes I open, if I do not walk in forgiveness, I do not yet know God. That's the truth. No matter what we claim to have, the knowledge of God is not expressed in how much money you have. Even unbelievers are rich in terms of money. But the knowledge of God gives you riches in terms of character first. Character, love, forgiveness, mercy, restraint. Joseph, Potiphar's wife, came to him. He ran away. That's the knowledge of God. He refused to touch her because his knowledge of God was constraining him to walk in holiness. If somebody knows God, he will show God. What you show is what you know. So if I want to know who you are or who is in you, I will check your character. Not what you say, how you live. What you say reveals what you think. But what you do reveals who you are. Thank you, Jesus. I am favored. It's what I think. Now, they see me now. If you now see me doing something which is against scripture, is who I am. No matter how people pray and fast, nobody can hide from his nature. If you hide this physically, it will come out in your dream. I'm telling you. You can pretend. You cannot pretend to yourself in your own dream who you are. If you hide it from us, you will see it there. Talking to somebody here. What am I saying? This is a call for us to understand that I am not reading this Bible to have a PhD in Bible reading. I am not reading the Bible to come and quote scripture. I am reading the Bible to become like God, to think like him, to talk like him, and to act like him. That's why I read the Bible. Is somebody here with me? That's why I read. That's why I read. That's why I read, people of God. when I woke up, I always ask myself, how can I become better today than yesterday? Before I sleep, when I'm on the bed, I always think about my faults of the day. I said, this thing I did was wrong. And when I finish thinking them, if there's a way to apologize on the spot, I call him and say, I'm sorry for what I told you in the morning. Papa, no, it's okay. I say, it's not okay for me. Oh. It's okay for you, not for me. I'm sorry that I spoke to you. Why? I want to be a better person because the true knowledge of God transforms a man's character into the character of God. Look at Mary Magdalene, a prostitute. When she met him, they proved that she met Jesus, and Jesus took 7 demons out of her by deliverance. But the proof that the demons left is that after that, she did not return to prostitution. It's not just confessing, I'm free, I'm free. The true expression of freedom, of I am free, is that you go and sin no more. If you still go and sin, you are not free, you are still a slave. Sometimes when I read the Bible, I'm afraid. I see a man like Solomon. With all the wisdom that man had, he married 1,000 women. I'm telling you, 1,000. I see Samson with the kind of strength that Samson had. One woman, one girl, Delilah. When a man cannot differentiate between a Delilah and a Ruth, a Delilah or an Esther, his hair, his eyes. When they caught Samson, the first thing they did, they pluck his eyes, the vision. When you meet the wrong woman, the first thing she does in your life, she takes away your vision. I'm talking to my brothers here. That's the first thing. Any wrong woman you meet, the first thing she will do, she will collect your vision. Then she take your hair, your glory. Your business that was going up will start coming down. You should know that not every woman is Esther. Someone's a Delilah. With all the strength he had, look at him. Look at Nebuchadnezzar, the rich man. Became a goat. 7 years. From the throne, posted to the minister of agriculture. Listen, no, we can laugh, but this God is not a joker. Hiya. Listen to me. You don't know God too. They don't provoke God though. We come and preach, God, my brother, God, God. Read from scripture, see the way God sample people. David, he wrote many psalms, more than 150 psalms. And David still took Bathsheba, slept with her, killed her husband. Bible says, and Bathsheba was pregnant. He said, David fasted 7 days, no food, no water. God still killed the child. God said, this child will not be healed. Enough end for the whole. And God said, David, for what you have done, you'll do it for you too. He said, the next week or the next month, the son of David took the wives of David and went to the roof of his palace. One boy with 8 women slept with them publicly. God was rewarding David for what he did with Bathsheba. But when he prayed, God told him, I have forgiven you. God? I don't know the God you heard though. If there's something with God, he said, I am a rewarder. Anything you plant, I will give you. You will harvest. Apostle Paul went about destroying Christians. He received Christ. Jesus, he told him, you will suffer for the things you will suffer. For he's a Christian now. He's a Christian. Jesus said, my brother, you will still suffer. I will show you how much you will suffer because you were there when they were persecuting Stephen. You will suffer. What am I trying to say? Let us live a life. Jesus said in John 8:29, he said, the Father has not left me because I do the things that please him. Let us live a life that expresses the knowledge we have of God. How can I say I know God and in my compound, I am the greatest one that looks for problem? How can I say I know God and they are seeing me walking around sleeping with women? How can I say I know God? I am the greatest corrupted and bribe-taking man in my office. The true knowledge of God must be expressed in a lifestyle of holiness. The true knowledge of God. What am I trying to say? We are not here to preach and tell you Greek and Hebrew. No. Every preaching must improve your character. That's the truth of it. No matter what I preach, what I preach for 8 hours or 10 minutes or 15 minutes, a message that helps you is a message that makes you repent of some wrong things and empower you to live a life that God will be glorified. If you come and say, man of God was blessed, I'm not preaching for you to be blessed. No. I'm preaching for you to change. What is the need of being blessed by my message and you are still living the same life you lived before the message? Then you are not blessed. The true blessing you receive from a message is that the message corrected a wrong lifestyle and empowered a right lifestyle. If any man should boast, hear what he says. Let him boast that he knows me, that I am the Lord. You see what he says, Jeremiah 9, verse 24 now. That I am the Lord, and hear what he says he does. But let him who boast about this year, that he understands and knows me, see, that I am the Lord, who exercises kindness, justice, righteousness. He said, you must know that this is my character. I am good, but I also a judge. I am good, but I'm a judge. And I bring forward righteousness. He said, for in these things I am happy. What does he mean? God is saying, I am happy when you show mercy. I am happy when you walk in love. I am happy when you help the poor. I told you, there is nothing that provokes the attention of heaven like when a Christian walks in love. Love is not I love you. No, love is I help you. I forgive you. I pray for you. That is love. But today, our love is I love you. That's fake. That's why I love you now. Next minute, kiss me. I love you, kiss me. I love you. See the kind of love? I love you, kiss me. It's a love of you want to take. But the Lord God so loved the way that he gave. The love that is expressed in sacrifice is the true love. You see, if you know that I am the Lord, know the things that make me happy. Goodness, justice, righteousness. Know that I am happy when you help the poor. Listen to me. In the eyes of men, you may be nothing. But in the eyes of God, you are great. I'm telling you. If you see some man of God, say against small church, they did 10. If you see a small man of God, we forgot the eye and a big man of God that. Then they might get big church, forgot the eye and a small man of God. Because in the eyes of God, what makes you big or small is not the size of your church, the size of your car, the size of the miracle of prophecy, is the size of your heart towards those who offend you. That's how God will check them. God will check how you react. He said, this one knows me. That I am the Lord who love kindness, righteousness, and justice. Am I talking to somebody here? We must listen to me. We must get better. We must get better. There are some women here. Let me tell you this. The reason why your husband has not yet accepted to come to church is because your character has not changed. You're only taking prophet Kevin, prophet Kevin, you just love his sin. That's why they're showing up at that church. There are some children here. Your parents don't like me or this church because of your character. No matter how you say I preach well, the true proof that I preach well is that you live well. A good message brings a good life. Are you listening to me here? So, when you come here, don't just look at the anointing that God has given me that can heal you and save you and deliver you. Look at the teaching that can build you and make you responsible. We live in a time where everybody wants money. Everybody wants fame. Everybody wants marriage. But God says, what I want is character. Have you not seen people? The other day, I saw a story of a man. He got married to his wife, January. He killed her last week. He beat her until she died. Now, if that man was praying for marriage and God said, you're not married now, you say God has refused to give him wife. But his character was not ready. There are certain blessings people have had. That is the reason why they are dead. That if God will have delayed it, you would have been angry and you say, I'm changing church. God has not, don't know that God is saying, I want to save you. Because no matter what God gives you, it is your character that sustains blessing. Your character. God can give a man a good wife. Because the man has a bad character, she becomes a bad woman. She was not bad though. He changed her by his bad character. Because people become what they see. God can give a woman a good husband, but her terrible character, the man changes. My husband has changed. Most often, people see the change in you. They don't see what made them change in them. You always say, I have changed. But there is something in you that made me change the way you see me now. That is why the greatest examination, Bible says, examine yourself, your heart, if you are still in the faith. Sit down and ask yourself, this life I'm living, am I okay? Never say nothing if you do me. No, Lord. That's why when I read Bible, I ask myself, is this how I'm living? You don't read Bible to mark exam that you have read. Today, I read 10 chapters of the Bible. It's not Bible reading competition. There is no PhD for Bible reading. Whether you read or you don't read, it doesn't change God. But I prefer a person who reads one verse of the Bible in one day and changes than a person who reads 10 and does not change. Question is this. You are a Christian. You have been in church for years. What has changed in your life? That's what God is asking. What has changed? Don't tell me you have had money. No. Man of God, before, I used to drink. I don't drink again. I used to smoke. I don't smoke. Now, it may not be a total change, but at least what has started changing by virtue of knowing God. But if you check today in church, our greatest testimony is, as I met the man of God, and I have money, everything is money, visa, money. Christianity is full of carnality. God said, let no man boast of his riches. We stand and we boast publicly of our riches before God and before the people of God. When what we should boast of, he says, sir, when I did not know God, this I was, but since I know God, this I am now. That's the greatest testimony. If any man should boast, let him boast that what? He knows me. And that I, the Lord, I love goodness, justice, and righteousness. What is righteousness? Holiness. He said, for in these things I'm happy. Child of God, people of God, I'd like you to understand, your character is a prophecy of your future. The way you behave today, we can easily predict where you will end tomorrow. Any man that boasts in anything that is not God, he will end up down tomorrow. But show me a man today that has nothing, but he say, I have God. Tomorrow, he will be up. The secret of greatness is to recognize the hand of God in your achievement. Whether you read how, if you pass exam, somebody read more than you. Say, thank you, Lord, for giving me success. James 1:17, every good and perfect gift cometh from above, from who? From the Father. It comes from where? Father. So when you go home, always take time to thank God for people in your life. Thank you for my wife. Thank you for my family. You gave it to me. Thank you for this. When Satan deceives us to think that what we have is by our strength, we don't recognize God again. But I can tell you this. No matter how you have struggled, somebody struggled more than you, did not have that thing you have. One time a man of God said, he came to me, he said, sir, please. Then he wants to do a fasting, he wants to prophesy like me. That's what he said. So he said, I should pray for him. He was going to do 40 days. Now, in the name of Jesus, I'm here. I never fasted to prophesy. I cannot lie. In fact, even up to now, those close to me know, I have never fasted to prophesy. I don't fast to prophesy. It's a gift of God. I didn't fast to have the gift to heal the sick. Jesus appeared to me and gave it to me. That is why I can, there's no one can say, how can I boast so to some man dash me? In I say, I'll be praying, I get him. I'll do that today. But I'm not praying. If I am praying today, I am praying as my fellowship with God. You see me. Whether I pray or don't pray, I can prophesy any time of my life. I be a prophet. Now gift. Whether I fast or don't fast, I can hear the sin. It's a gift of the Spirit. My prayer and my Bible study is for my fellowship with God. So, how can I be boasting today? I told you that one time we had a service and there were about 1,800 people on prayer line. I remember that day, and that day about 72 lame people walk. We had about 37 blind eyes open. At the end, God said, go and dry clean floor. I said, me, I don't tire. I said in my heart, too. I said, after all that work, so. And God said, Kevin, when you were on the prayer line, I was the one walking through you. He said, you, go and dry clean the floor. Work for me now. That's when I understood that when we prophesy, when we heal the sick, God is walking through us. That from that time, I joined sanitation department. When I come there working, I dry clean because I want to work for God. But if I now think that I have become a mega or whatever, because I can prophesy. So they say you are gone off. Let the gift that God has given you not make you change your name. Let God change your name by himself. Am I talking to somebody here? This is the reason why today there is so much trouble in people increasing their life. They don't appreciate anything. Because I saw a man, he spoke to his wife, he said, if you make that thing, you come off my house. I look, I called them and said, how will you talk so? Because for him, he has money. In fact, he bought the woman from my family. I felt pain. I said, can you talk to her? He said, Master, man of God, about the step. I said, about the step. Guess what? The woman left the house. You know where that man is now? He's dead. He died. And the woman go. 4 months, he see he died. And on his deathbed, he was coming. Man of God, call my wife. I said, why should I call your wife now? When I was speaking, you thought I was your enemy. Man of God, you know what you don't do me. I said, my brother, leave the thing. That's how life is. So when you think that who you are is yourself that made it, you will oppress people. You know what you are doing before I reach here? Now that talk will kill you. Any person, you see me, there's nothing anybody can do to me, because I know that whatever I am today is the grace of God. And the grace that brought me here sustains me here. But by the time I think that it was my prayer, the day I not pray, they go press me for night. Now my prayer, they kill me. So listen, you see me, even me, I swear, sometimes I lay pray, ask my woman. Now true, no, no, man, I'm going to lie, woman. Sometimes they will die. Don't be true, mommy. You don't come for night, I said, don't die, I steal me. You woke up, pray, touch my head, I cover you. I said, cover me, if I cover me with the blood of Jesus. Cover me, he said, I cover you. I cover you, I said, mommy, cover them. I need. Sometimes me, I get angry. I said, God, I need to pray again. In fact, I need to go to church today. I sleep in my woman, can pray with me. I cover you. I say, cover me with the blood. Cover fire. Cover me. Oh, and I pray. But I still wake up. Which means not my prayer that sustain me. It's the grace of God. You see me here. Listen here. If there is something that trouble does, trouble makes you appreciate what you have. Then you never appreciate it. I tell you. You know, a woman brought a child to me. And this is funny. She bought a child, and the child was actually about 6 or 5. The child was not walking. Then another woman, but she was standing for me. Another woman was with her child, and the child was walking, and she was pushing the child. And I laugh. I say, life funny. When a child does his first step, everybody clap. And he start walking, nobody clap again. Do you know that when your child walks first, you guess Jesus, because not walking. Thank you, Jesus. You forget to thank the Jesus that has kept him walking. So for you, Jesus only made him to make the first step. Now he's making the next step by his strength. The same Jesus that raised him to start walking is the one keeping him to walk. But most of us, we don't see that. Until the day the child fall, in the walk again. Man of God, pray, I beg, I pray. So they begin here for fall before he knows that Jesus make her. Tell you, so sometimes trouble can make you appreciate what you do not appreciate. I think I heard a story of who was telling me something yesterday. My mom let me tell me about that man. Is it you that the wife travel? No, the husband travel, and the husband was caught in the bush. The man only 2 days today. The woman not gave him phone call for you. Now before the woman went, they became problem. When the man come back, the woman said, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, don't come back. She embraced the man. The man was surprised. All the anger in her heart had left. Because she thought the man was dead. She said, Jesus, oh God, oh, thank you, so don't come back. Jesus, I love you, I love you. The problem was settled by the trouble. 2 days, no phone call. She said, no, me, that's what happened. She was here every day praying on the altar. Now, that is a man. This woman came to complain to me last week. Then the man traveled. Now, nah, phone call there. Man of God, my husband. I said, I thought you said there's trouble. He said, man of God, hey, we are Christians. Leave that one first. I said, no, there's a problem. Lady, he said, man of God, I beg, pray. It's my only one. I said, it's your only one. That I could not believe this is the same person that criticized that man. Man of God, my husband does not love me. He's useless. That day. Now, I was repeating. I said, you are praying for you. And I said, man of God, my husband is not useless. God forbid. My husband is not useless. Wait till that happen now. They say, now, they told me that when the woman lost my kid, she ran. Thank you, oh Jesus. Oh, God, oh,
thank you. You don't answer my prayer. What happened? She thought she had lost him. But should you wait to that kind of moment before you recognize what you have? Rise on your feet, oh.